Chapter 30.
My dear Wormwood, I sometimes wonder whether you think you have been sent into the world for your own amusement. I gather, not from your miserably inadequate report, but from that of the infernal police, that the patient's behavior during the first raid has been the worst possible. He has been frightened and thinks himself a great coward and therefore feels no pride, but he has done everything his duty demanded, and perhaps a bit more. Against this disaster, all you can produce on the credit side is a burst of ill temper with a dog that tripped him, some excessive cigarette smoking, and the forgetting of a prayer. What is the use of whining to me about your difficulties? If you are proceeding on the enemy's idea of justice and suggesting that your opportunities and intentions should be taken into account, then I am not sure that a charge of heresy does not lie against you. At any rate, you will soon find that the justice of hell is purely realistic and concerned only with results. Bring us back food. Or be food yourself. The only constructive passage in your letter is where you say that you still expect good results from the patient's fatigue. That is well enough. But it won't fall into your hands. Fatigue can produce extreme gentleness and a quiet of mind, and even something like a vision. If you have often seen men led by it into anger, malice, and impatience, it is because those men have had efficient tempters. The paradoxical thing is that moderate fatigue is a better soil for peevishness than absolute exhaustion. This depends partly on the physical causes, but partly on something else. It is not fatigue, simply as such, that produces the anger, but unexpected demands on a man already tired. Whatever men expect, they soon come to think they have a right to. The sense of disappointment can, with very little skill on our part, be turned into a sense of injury. It is after men have given in to the irremediable, after they have despaired of relief, and ceased to think, even half an hour ahead, that the dangers of humbled and gentle weariness begin. To produce the best results from the patient's fatigue, therefore, you must feed him with false hopes. Put into his mind plausible reasons for believing that the air raid will not be repeated. Keep him comforting himself with the thought of how much he will enjoy his bed next night. Exaggerate the weariness by making him think it will soon be over. For men usually feel that a strain could have been endured no longer at the very moment when it ended, or when they think it is ending. In this, as in the problem of cowardice, the thing to avoid is the total commitment. Whatever he says, let his inner resolution be not to bear whatever comes to him, but to bear it for a reasonable period. And let the reasonable period be shorter than the trial is likely to last. It need not be much shorter. In attacks on patience, chastity, and fortitude, the fun is to make the man yield just when, had he but known it, relief was almost in sight. I do not know whether he is likely to meet the girl under conditions of strain or not. If he does, make full use of the fact that, up to a certain point, fatigue makes women talk more. And men talk less. Much secret resentment, even between lovers, can be raised from this. Probably the scenes he is now witnessing will not provide material for an intellectual attack on his faith. Your previous failures have put that out of your power. But there is a sort of attack on the emotions which can be tried. It turns on making him feel, when he first sees human remains plastered on a wall, that this is what the world is really like, and that all his religion has been a fantasy. You will notice that we have got them completely fogged about the meaning of the word real. They tell each other of some great spiritual experience. All that really happened was that you heard some music in a lighted building. Here, real means the bare physical facts, separated from the other elements in the experience they actually had. On the other hand, they will also say, it's all very well discussing that high dive as you sit there in an armchair, but wait until you get up there and see what it's really like. Here, real is being used in the opposite sense, to mean not the physical facts, which they know already while discussing the matter in armchairs, but the emotional effect those facts will have on a human consciousness. Either application of the word could be defended, but our business is to keep the two going at once, so that the emotional value of the word real can be placed now on one side of the account, now on the other, as it happens to suit us. The general rule, which we have now pretty well established among them, is that in all experiences which can make them happier, or better, only the physical facts are real, while the spiritual elements are subjective. In all experiences which can discourage or corrupt them, the spiritual elements are the main reality, and to ignore them is to be an escapist. Thus, in birth, the blood and the pain are real, the rejoicing a mere subjective point of view. In death, the terror and ugliness reveal what death really means. The hatefulness of a hated person is real. In hatred, you see men as they are. You are disillusioned. But the loveliness of a loved person is merely a subjective haze concealing a real core of sexual appetite or economic association. War and poverty are really horrible. Peace and plenty are mere physical facts about which men happen to have certain sentiments. The creatures are always accusing one another of wanting to eat the cake and have it. But thanks to our labors, they are more often in the predicament of paying for the cake and then not eating it. Your patient, properly handled, will have no difficulty in regarding his emotion at the sight of human entrails as a revelation of reality, and his emotion at the sight of happy children or fair weather as mere sentiment. Your affectionate uncle, Screwtape.